Joining us now for a post-Fed pre-BSB chat is RCBC's chief economist, Mike Ricafort. Hi, Mike. Good morning. Thank you so much for taking our call.
Hi, good morning, Mimi and PR view.
All right. So it seems the Fed delivered an early Christmas gift to markets. Will the BSB or Banco Central be as generous, maybe even more?
Yeah, it's possible, Mimi, considering now that, at least the dot plot, the Federal Reserve, the Fed officials are of the view that Fed rates could be reduced by 75 basis points. However, the markets are thinking much, much more. The Fed fund futures are pricing in cuts of 150 basis points for next year. And the earliest now, post Fed meeting, is 25 basis points as early as March. So there's a good chance for many central banks, including ours, to also move in line with those possible cuts. Mm-hmm. Although for now, it's still a pause to make sure. Well, what's really key here is the inflation would move back towards the central bank's target. And that's already, it's already very much possible soon. Mm-hmm. Maybe as early as December or most likely January to February at 3% or even less than 3%. That's already well within the inflation target of 2-4%. So that would already set the base and to eventually lay the groundwork before, well, if the Fed starts cutting rates as early as the first quarter as the markets are pricing in. So that's likely to be much locally because our inflation is already well anchored and controlled by then. Or we just have to manage some risk factors like El Nino that mm-hmm. could lead to some pickup in rice, local rice prices. So it's still a wait and see though. Oil prices are still relatively low at between $68 to $69 per barrel. That's already the lowest in more than 5 months. And we have seen the markets really reacting very positively. It's already the Santa Claus rally, especially in the U.S. Dow Jones at the new record high, and the S&P 500 and NASDAQ already at near 2-year highs and also nearing the record highs. And Mimi, go ahead.
Mike, just very quickly, have you crunched the numbers? Have you pushed your pencils to see what, for example, a 25 basis point rate cut by the BSP could mean, how much it could add to the Philippine GDP numbers? Because, you know, there's still a debate whether the aggressive rate hiking cycle of past has already hurt growth, our growth, significantly. If you reverse that, what will the easing mean? I mean, how much more growth are we looking at for every 25 bips cut in the benchmark policy rate?
Yeah, true, Mimi. We have seen rate hikes since last year, but the latest GDP growth as of the third quarter already stood at 5.9%. So meaning, had it not been for the rate hikes locally and globally, so GDP growth would have easily reached 6%. So there's a very good chance now, starting next year, there would be rate cuts indeed, as priced in by the markets. If at least 100 basis point cut, we could see GDP growth of at least 6 to 6.5%. So that's already workable because if inflation eases further, the year-on-year inflation, that could help at least in terms of increased spending by consumers, by many businesses and industries, by government and other institutions. So definitely that would help now, especially that, what's holding everything together right now, oil prices remain relatively low. It's okay. Even much lower compared to when the two wars started. Okay. The Russia-Ukraine war, it was $92. Mm-hmm. And when it started, and now the Israel-Hamas war, when it started October 7, it was like $82 to $83. Now it's already much lower at $68 to $69 per barrel.
It is the silver lining indeed. I want to bring in some thoughts from one of your colleagues in the economic space, from BPI, Jun Neri. He was pointing out that Indonesia, despite having the highest policy rate among the ASEAN 5 economies, has managed to keep its economy strong stronger than the Philippines. They've actually managed to move up the manufacturing value chain. So I guess it leads us to question, thus low or maybe negative rates, like Japan, help a country outperform necessarily?
Well,
we know it's not the elixir, it's not a magic bullet, but does it necessarily help a country's economy outperform everyone else when you've got low interest rates, or do you need structural reforms to do that?
Well, the structural reforms are more important, especially, of course, you need to attract more investment, especially FDI. So it would mean lowering the cost of doing business, like lowering the electricity cost, meaning more electricity supply, enabled to make it more profitable for locators to come in, and among many other things. So it's really the structural. And of course, the potential is there. The Philippines has the 12th largest population in the world, and our rankings, for remittances, we're number 4 in the world, that more than 40 billion, that's both personal and cash remittances per year. So after India, China, and Mexico, we even overtook Mexico about more than 5 years ago at some point. And for BPOs, we're number 2 after India. It's earning more than $35 billion per year and still projected to grow further. And we're number 1 in the call center industry. That's 70 to 80% of the total BPO. And and tourism is a low-hanging fruit. So that's also an area for a country to catch up more with the rest of the region. So the structural, of course, boosting productivity by using technology for agriculture, especially now that there are challenges by El Nino, and also boosting the productivity of manufacturing, since both agriculture employs almost a quarter of the total workforce, and enabled to achieve the middle income country status. So it's important to alleviate more people out of poverty. Yeah,
and Mike, if I may just add, a lot of investors and businessmen are actually very happy that our Agri Chief, Secretary Francisco T. Laurel, has said he will focus on logistics. They say that's a critical part of making, you know, policy easing sustainable, because you've got inflation well anchored, because we know that logistics forms a very big part of the cost that goes into these agri products. Final question, Mike, just a big picture, just an overall view. What are your expectations for 2024 in terms of BSP moves? How many cuts and how deep will the cuts be, starting when for 2024? What is your inflation forecast for 2024 and your GDP fearless forecast? Just very quickly, just the numbers.
Yeah, for local policy rate cuts, so it could mirror or move in line with what the Fed would do. So it's between 100 to 150 basis points cut. So from 6.5%, it could go down to between 5% to 5.5%. Okay. So and then for inflation, provided that the geopolitics remain relatively the two wars remain relatively manageable by the world powers, and prevent and escalation, especially the Israel-Hamas war, and oil remains relatively low, and oil, and of course, inflation is managed and rice prices are managed well. Mm-hmm. So it's possible to see 3.6 to 3.7% inflation for next year. That's the base estimate if things remain the same, meaning remain manageable.
Status quo. All right.
So yeah,
and GDP growth.
GDP, at least 6% to 6.5%. Still among the fastest growing economies, because we're coming from a low base. So it's really the time for the Philippines to shine, in the sense that we're in a favor of, the demographic sweet spot. That has been our trend average. We need to move towards the middle income country status, and majority of the population working age. So that would really boost in terms of incomes, spending power, and of course, education is very important, because that's the biggest equalizer, and it would really move more people out of poverty.
All right.
Going forward.
On that note, Mike, always a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for your insights today. See you soon and happy holidays.
Thank you so much, Mimi, and your viewers, and happy holidays.
All right.